Welcome back. We'll start with the next chapter for Political Science Class 9. And in this chapter, we'll talk about the electoral politics. Now, let's have a quick idea or a kind of summary about the chapter, and then we'll move on to the details of the chapter. So, let's say you have 10 students in a class, and the teacher wants to elect a class representative from those 10 students. What the teacher can do is ask the 10 students to sit together and then find out who would be a best fit for the position. So that is something where you do a kind of direct contest or a direct election, and through that direct election, all the members or all the students can sit together, have their opinions, have their views about individual candidates, they can discuss the various things, and finally they can have one person who can come out as a class representative. So that's a kind of very simple case. But when we talk about a nation with a population of more than billions, what would happen is when you have a huge group of population, bringing them all together is a difficult task. Then asking them all together to be at a one place or at one time and discuss the things together is definitely a difficult task. So for that you have the indirect basically kind of elections that takes place, and those elections or those electoral politics is what we would understand here. So when you have the elections that takes place, what would happen is you would have one party that would bring out its own agenda, but that election cannot be one-sided, and you would have a kind of another party that would be representing, or that would be known as the opposition party that would have its own agenda. Both of these parties, the party and the opposition party, would contest the election, and then both of them would release their own campaigns and they would lay down their own promises. Finally, when it comes to public or the voting, now this election procedure could be either direct or indirect. Now, most of the elections that we take place in a democratic setup are direct elections, for example, direct elections to Lok Sabha. However, you have indirect elections to the post of president. So, people don't directly vote for the president, but you have the indirect voting that takes place through the members of Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha. So, you have the various kind of elections that takes place, and finally, through that election, you have one representative or one candidate that wins the election. Now, when we talk about, let's say this is an area or a state. So, let's assume this to be a state of India. Now, this state is divided into various districts. I'm just doing it in a kind of linear fashion so that you can well understand the concept. However, when it comes to elections, you don't go by the political boundaries. You go by the boundaries that are being defined by the Election Commission in India. And Election Commission basically defines the boundaries as electoral constituencies. So you have this, let's say, would be one electoral constituency. So this would include some of the districts and like one complete district and some of the other parts of the districts. So, this becomes one constituency, and let's say the remaining whole of it becomes another constituency. So, constituencies are defined not by the political boundaries but by the boundaries laid down by the Election Commission. Now, once you have the electoral constituency, each constituency would have one representative, or there would be one representative that would come out from each electoral constituency. So let's say in Lok Sabha we have 543 constituencies, and each person would represent one constituency. Again, in this constituency, some of the constituencies are known as reserved constituency. The reserved constituency word itself means that you have certain seats or certain constituencies which have predominant population of, let's say, scheduled caste or scheduled tribes, and therefore you have the candidate or the representative who would be representing that specific group of people. So it could be scheduled caste or scheduled tribes, so SC, ST. So there are certain constituencies which are reserved. Now for each constituency, you have general elections that takes place. These general elections are usually occurring at the same time for most of the constituencies within a given area. Now we are talking more about electoral reform. So now you have different elections for the post of Lok Sabha, different elections for states or Vidhan Sabha. But now we are talking about electoral reforms where the proposed idea is all the elections should be unified and should take place at a common time. However, coming on to the topic, you have general elections where different constituencies conduct election at a given point of time. However, in some cases you have by-elections, those are held, and these by-elections are held in circumstances like the death of the existing representative or sudden vacancy of the representative due to removal of the representative and so on. So that is where you have by-elections that take place. Now, for every election, till now you used to have a paper ballot. So you would have a paper, and on that paper, let's say you have the different political parties A, B, C, D. What you have to do is you have to mark in front of the political party that you want to vote. If you are putting two ticks or two votes across two different parties, that ballot would be considered as invalid. However, with recent developments and the idea of reducing the paper usage, we are moving towards the EVM, those are the electronic voting machines. So in the electronic voting machine, you have the various name of the parties and you have to just press the button in front of the name of the political party that you want to vote. Again, with these elections in 2018, you had the idea of VVPAT 2017, that is voter verified paper audit trails. So under this, you would have a paper trail that would come simultaneously with the each person's vote that has been given. So there can be a kind of cross-checking or verification that the EVM mark, the press that you have done on EVM, and that result that has come on the paper audit trail is one and the same. So that's kind of a kind of double check measure or verification purpose that you have this VVPATs that are being introduced. However, this is of recent. Now again, for elections in India, when we talk specifically about India, every adult above the age of 18 years has the right to vote, except the cases of some persons who are from unsound mind or a criminal background. So what happens during this process is you have the process of election that takes place. This election takes place at a place which is known as polling booth. So at the polling booth, you enter in, on your finger you have the mark that is put up, and finally you cast your vote. So that vote is also known as poll, and once you have the poll that is done, all the polls done at that station are collected together, and then on a single day across all constituencies you would have the counting that would be done, and through the process of that counting you would have the final results that would be out. So that's the process how election takes place. So in summary, we can say first you have the announcement of the election. So the dates of the elections are announced, then you nominate the candidates. Now this is again a very interesting concept. How the candidates are nominated? Let's say I want to nominate myself as a candidate for Lok Sabha. What all things that would be there that I will have to do? So I will have to have a details of all the questions that are being asked, specifically pertaining to the assets, liabilities, my criminal background and my educational qualification. However, in India, educational qualification is not must, because if we say that only graduates could be part of the politics, 90% of the eligible citizens would be out. So that's again, you have the list for the nomination. So candidates finally nominate themselves. Then the nominations are scrutinized. Some of the candidates are withdrew, which are considered unsound or having a criminal background, or the election commission decides which candidates would finally come and which would not for contest the elections. All the parties having their representatives or the candidates start campaigning. After the campaigning, you have polling and counting, as we have already explained. So as we said, if there would be a democracy without elections, be it a direct election or an indirect election, all the candidates would have to sit together, have to discuss the ideas and views. It would take a lot of time and require a lot of patience from everyone. Now, how the representatives can be selected? Representatives can be selected based on age, knowledge, experience, if you are not giving a election as a parameter. However, when you lay down election as a parameter, people try to choose a person who can make laws, who can bring things in their favor, who can speak their voice in the parliament, and finally a party who could have good policies so that the common man could benefit. As we said, elections could be democratic or non-democratic. Now, for a democratic elections, what are the conditions that are important? So, choices should be given at regular intervals. Candidates should, the preferred candidates should be elected. And finally, you have the election procedure that should be fair and free, as we said. Now, the political competition. So, as we said, elections are good because it creates competition. If there would be just one single party, that party works or not, that party would remain in power. So if there are elections, there is a opposition party. So opposition party has a constant pressure on the ruling party, and therefore you have more incentives that come to the people. You have a healthy competition that pertains in. However, some demerits include the disunity and the issues of factionalism. Now, when the party is in power, it tries to serve best to the people. It tries to improve the knowledge and the character of the representatives. It's similar to a shopkeeper behavior. So if you go to the shopkeeper and ask for some product, he'll try to make that product available to you, considering the fact that if he does not, you would move on to the next shop and he would lose one of his customers. So same is the issue with the political leaders. They try to maintain their constituencies. They try to work hard to improve their constituencies so that in the next elections that would they could subsequently win a seat again. Election systems, we have already discussed what are general elections, by-elections, the constituencies, then the member of parliaments. So all those representatives who win here are selected as a member of parliament when it is an election for at the national level. When it is an election at the state level, they win as a representative for Vidhan Sabha. So you have the Legislative Assembly or the Lok Sabha, for which you have the members that are elected. For Lok Sabha, it is known as Member of Parliament or MPs. For Legislative Assembly, they are known as Members of Legislative Assemblies or MLAs. So you have the reserved constituency that we have already talked about. Then the electoral list. So electoral list is a very, very important concept to understand. We said all the eligible persons are mentioned in the electoral list. So all those whose names are there in the electoral list can go and vote. Now let's say if a person is demised, so you would have that person's name that would be removed. You have new person who turns out 18 and that person would be joining the electoral list. So it's a kind of constant update that has to be maintained in the electoral list or the voter list. So you have adding of the names, you have deletion of the names that constantly take place, and then you have the photo identity card. Those are issued and those are known as the election card. So those cards provide identity to every person. Now, as we said, if I want to contest an election from party X, so that party would give me a ticket and that would be known as the party ticket. So it's the party's nomination for my name and I would be contesting on behalf of that party. So I would give all my details that are required. Now, when you have the election campaign that comes up, you have various slogans that are put up. For example, during the Indira Gandhi's government in 71, you had the slogan of Garibi Hatao or Remove Poverty. Now, when you are putting up the slogans, you are promising the people basically that with this election, if we come to power, we would have a basic agenda of removal of poverty. Now, some of the promises are kept and some of those are not kept. In 77, Janata Party said that the existing government has done a lot of excesses and during the procedure of emergency. So what we would do is we would try to save the democracy. So Janata Party led the slogan Save Democracy in 77. In West Bengal, you had the idea of land to the tillers. Similarly, in Andhra Pradesh, you had protect the self-respect of the Telugus, and so on and so forth. So according to our election laws, no party can basically bribe a voter, appeal them to cast vote in name of a specific caste or a specific religion, use government resources for the process of campaigning, or spend more than 25 lakhs for Lok Sabha and 10 lakhs for assembly elections. So if any of these is found, the name of the candidate is removed from the list. When we talk about the model code of conduct, the idea is you would not use any place of worship as a part of your party agenda. You would not have used government vehicles or government resources for the process of campaigning. You would, once the election dates are announced or the elections are announced, ministers cannot lay the foundation stone for any running project or give out or release any big policy that could change the mindset of the people. So that's the basic idea. Polling and the polling booths we have already discussed. Now expenses on Lok Sabha. 2004 election shows nearly 1300 crores were spent on the process of election. That comes to be a huge amount and accounts for nearly rupees 20 per person. However, if we go on to the real statistics and try to understand, when government decided to buy 6 nuclear submarines from France, each of the submarine cost around 3000 crores. The amount that we spent on the Olympic Games in 2010 was 10,000 crores. So definitely our expenditure on election is much less than that. And then that expenditure is important to have a good ruling party that could bring in drastic or dynamic changes to the country. Now again, what are the activities that defeat the purpose of the democracy? If you have false name in the electoral list, if you have the misuse of the name of a genuine candidate, misuse of the government facilities, excessive use of money by the rich candidates, or intimidation of the voters or rigging on the polling booth. So all those are some of the malpractices that exist. So definitely they are a big challenge to the existing democratic process or the process of election. Now, what is Election Commission? Election Commission is an independent body. So that independent body conducts the election. And that body is not answerable to the government, and no one can remove the Chief Election Commission. So government cannot, or the government does not have the power to remove the Chief Election Commission. The decisions are made on every aspect of conduct and control of elections, implementing the code of conduct. The rules set out during the process of election, conducting the elections. When on government duty, the government officials should be very unbiased, and if there is any flaw found, that administration can lapse. If the Election Commission feels there was some malpractices that took place at a particular election booth, that election can be asked to repoll, or repolling could be conducted on that seat. Now the next important thing is turnout. So turnout is the number of candidates who come out and vote. Now this turnout has been declining in the developed nations of, let's say, America and Europe. However, in India it has more or less been stable, or we can say it's growing. The next is the poor illiterate are more in amount in terms of voting in India as compared to other nations. Common people are strongly attached to the process of election in India, considering the fact that there could be big reforms that could affect the common people, and the interest of the voters, voter related activities has been increasing among the people over the years. So you have the two graphs here that shows the upper caste OBC, SC, ST, and you have more or less the same proportion of voting. However, in America you have a significant low amount of voting turnout for Hispanics as compared to whites. When it comes to the number of candidates who are basically contesting the elections, you can see, or who are actively engaged in the process of election, that number has been significantly increasing. Now, acceptance of the outcome. So the ruling party routinely loses the election. So when we can say the election process is fair and transparent, most of the cases the ruling party loses the next elections, then In US, you have a sitting elected representative that really loses the election, in contrast to India. So you have the candidates who are known to spend a lot of money to buy the votes, and you have candidates with criminal background who use power to push out other candidates from the existing seat. But there are these kind of issues that come into notice, but still, more or less, most of the constituencies have a kind of people's verdict when it comes to the final election process or the election voting that takes place. Now, the challenges, as we said, are the people with money power get undue advantage. Some of the candidates who are contesting as independent candidate do not have that much of resources to put in. So, candidates supporting huge parties have a added advantage. We try to provide a level playing field for all the candidates, but that practically does not take place. Then again, you have candidates with criminal party who use undue muscle power, as we said, and some families who have a tendency to dominate the political scenario. Then you have the issues of booth capturing and rigging that takes place. So rigging is basically the malpractices indulged by the party, and booth capturing is using the muscle power to capture a booth physically and change the amount of the votes or create false votes for a given party. So those are the things that usually takes place. So with this, we cover chapter 4, the electoral politics, how elections takes place, why democracy, how a democracy with election and without election would be different. Now, some of the important questions that could come up from this chapter is, what are general elections? What are by-elections? What is turnout? So these are some of the terms that could be asked. Then again, a very important question for your long answer could be, what are the challenges that an Indian democracy face? So you have the list of challenges here. That's again very, very important. How the election campaign takes place and what is the polling procedure? What is the role of election commission and the role of chief election commissioner? So those are some of the important questions that we have tried to bring out from this lesson. Stay tuned for further two chapters for political science, and then we'll move ahead to class 10. Have a very good day ahead.